So I have more of a user perspective to GitHub. So I would actually like to start by thanking you developers for implementing and maintaining all these nice features so that I only have to use this one program. And then I'll tell you a little bit about what we have done for the last half year within GitHub. So myself, Umberto Martinez, and our boss, Björk Hammer, we have tried to model photo reactions by some simple methods. And of course, what appropriate systems look at if you want to investigate the photo reactions is titanium dioxide. Many of you may know that it has some self-cleaning applications. So here we have a surface that is coated with titanium dioxide layer, and we see that it can degrade the organic pollutants when it is exposed to sunlight. And what happens is that the electron hole pairs, photons come down and create the holes and electrons in the titanium dioxide. And then, for instance, if we want to oxidize away organic pollutants, then the holes are involved in oxidation of organic molecules. It could be methyl chloride, as we will look at later, where one proton is transferred to some oxygen on the titanium dioxide. So this would be the first step in the photo reaction, and then this would have to be degraded further. So of course, if we wanted an ideal model for this problem, we would have to be able to investigate the creation of electron hole pairs, the recombination, and how we could go from the excited state through chronicle interception down to the ground state where all the energy is lost vibrations, and then finally how we could go to some product state. We see here that we have the electron is not used in this process because it's a pure oxidation. So in principle we could just try and remove it from the system. If we do that, then of course we have made this up here a ground state system because now the hole cannot combine with anything. And then we could in principle try to investigate this in DFT where we can investigate the ground state problems. Of course now we cannot get to the real ground state, but we can hope to investigate the road to the product state. To create a hole in this setup, of course we could try and charge the cell, but that has some problems when we want to have a periodic boundary condition. So what we've chosen to do is simply to add an OH group on the surface of the titanium dioxide and then hope that this is electronegative enough to pull away an electron from the crystal. And we can see here we have the 110 surface, which is the most studied surface of the rutile TiO2 with titanium trough going here and bridging oxygen here. And now we have put in one OH group in the titanium trough. And we see from the density of state that this actually creates a hole in the top of the valence band. And we can also see from the projected dust onto the OH group that lies down here, so the hole must sit on the crystal rather than at the OH group. There's been some discussions in the literature whether this is actually an appropriate model for a hole in titanium dioxide, where there are some evidence that the hole might localize, especially if we have low coordinated oxygen species. But this we cannot really investigate in DFT because of the self-interaction error. What we can do is to look at both PBE and PBE plus U2 having a Hubbard U correction. Here I have put into my system to get an under-coordinated oxygen atom. I have put what's called a terminal oxygen in the titanium trough. This has a higher weight close to the hole than the OH group had, but still it's the hole is not localized on this species, even though some experiments suggest that it should. On the other hand, if we go to PV plus U and put a new correction to the P orbitals of the oxygen atom, then we can get this nice localized hole. But of course, if this is the correct situation, then it's a poor start to have the hole just in the top of the valence band. But we might be saved, because what we can see here is that the hole, so here we don't have any hole localization, and here we have, and that creates, builds up what is called a polar run, where the bond length between the titanium and the oxygen is increased. So what we can do now is to try to increase this, decrease the bond length back towards what it was without any localization. So here we have gone to 0.1 less distance, and we see now that the defect state is actually moved quite a lot down towards the top of the valence band. But what's more important is that the energy cost of doing this is very small. We can go a little bit further. So now we can move it actually half an eV closer to the valence band and only pay 0.14 eV to do this. So a small energy correction could bring the gap state down close to the valence band maximum, and then it sort of seems plausible that we could use a description where the hole is just at the top of the valence band. So that is what we have done. Now I would like to look at the example where we put oxidized methyl fluoride, and we have chosen this because there are some old experiments where methyl fluoride on the titanium dioxide 110 surface by itself doesn't give any reaction when exposed to UV light. But if we have oxygen together with the molecule, then we get some photoreaction with where formaldehyde is a major product both without and with water. So it seems that water influence what kind of products we can get, but the main thing is that oxygen is present on the surface. Another thing that was discovered was that the surface needs to be annealed, and they associate with the creation of oxygen vacancies on the 110 surface. So here, an oxygen vacancy is just a missing oxygen in these friction oxygen rows. But to get some further atomic insight into what is actually happening, we could maybe use our model to investigate this. The first question is, what could we actually have of surface species when we have a combination of oxygen vacancies and O2 molecules? One thing is that we could heal the vacancy and have the bridging oxygen. These we would of course always have on the surface. Then we could also get terminal oxygens, the ones that you saw before, where holes would like to localize. And then if we also have water, we could also get terminal hydroxys on the surface. So now we would like to check if these oxygen species can work as proton acceptors in the C8 bond breaking, which is the first step of the photooxidation of this methyl fluoride. So first, of course, we need to see how the methyl fluoride absorbs on the 110 surface. What we found is that in PB, the absorption is quite weak. But if we go to either M06L or to beef fanulars, we see that the absorption is increased. So it seems that methyl fluoride is probably slightly polarized with the fluoride atom being a little bit negative. So it seems reasonable that there might be some dispersion interactions between fluoride and the surface that is captured in either M06L or in the beef van der Waals that is not present in PD. We already at this point had some knowledge about using M06L, so we would actually like to have done that. But in a second, I want to transfer this proton down to the oxygen, quenching oxygens, making a lot of reactive species. And I'm probably not the only one who knows that M06L, it can be very difficult to converge, especially when we have a lot of not so stable species. So it actually turned out that it was completely impossible to investigate this reaction with the M06L. So we were quite pleased that we had just discovered that the van der Waals functional had been implemented that we could now use, and that which converged reasonable for these kind of problems. I should maybe mention that the TPD peak from experiments suggests that the binding energy should be around half MeV. So these are quite good, while PB definitely underbinds. So we used the B van der Waals 2x2 K point, a grid spacing of around a little less than 0.18 angstrom. We used a 4x2 surface cell with 4 trial layers in thickness. So what we see here, when we just have the hole and the molecule, so this the OH group here produces the hole. So we can see from the density of states that we have a hole here in the top of the valence band, as expected. And then we have made a projected dust onto the carbon atom of this molecule, and we can see that all the molecular states lie quite deep in the valence band of titanium dioxide. Now going to the transition state of transferring this proton down to the bridging oxygens. We now see that actually one of the molecular orbitals here has been moved above the Fermi level and been the electron has gone from here and healed the hole. So that seems to be the mechanism for this photoreaction. And finally, when we have transferred the proton completely, we get with a P state in the band gap that goes, goes down towards the hydrogen. But of course, it's the energetics that decides whether this reaction is possible. And we see that at the transition state, we are actually well above the absorption energy of this molecule, which means that it could not really happen on the surface. So we need to look into some of the other proton acceptors that we just found were plausible to have on the surface. So first, with the OH group in the trough, again here the transition state, and here we have produced water and the radical. And we see now that the barrier is 0.35, which is just below the absorption energy of the binding energy of the molecule, which means that we can actually, this reaction can actually happen at some temperature range without the molecule dissolving from the surface. And then finally, having an oxygen, terminal oxygen, which is the most reactive of these species, we see that the reaction goes very easily. But of course, these are all with the hole present. So what influence is there actually from the hole? So now we, of course, try to do it without the hole. And again, with the most reactive species, the terminal oxygen as a proton acceptor, now we see without the hole, everything is very unfavorable, both the transition and the final state. So it seems that we have now two species that can catalyze this, perform this bond breaking. So now it's interesting to see whether this radical can actually end up in some stable, become some stable molecule. So we start with the terminal oxygen that has now received a proton and want to react the radical back down to the oxygen of this surface species. So then first we have to flip everything around so that it can attack from the back. That goes very easily. Here I should say that now we try to manipulate this radical species, and now we also get some convergence problems within the B van der Waals. Well, we had, so we were so far now that we didn't want to go back and change, pick another exchange correlation function. So what we needed to do instead was to increase the fermion width of the fermion Dirac distribution until we could get some convergence. So these points here with the dashed circle is calculated with 2.14 instead of 2.08 eV as a fermion width. And that gives an artificial stabilization of these points of about 0.05. But it was what we needed to do to actually get the points to converge. Okay, but from this configuration here, we can attack the OH group with a very small barrier, get to this stable species, and then through some small thermal barriers, we can get the formaldehyde that was expected from the experiments. When we had the OH as a proton acceptor, we created water, and that is actually too stable for the radical to attack. But what we knew of the radical have a high line state in the band gap. So what we can do is actually to introduce a second hole. That will of course then depopulate this state here in the band gap. This lies 1 eV roughly above the valence band maximum. So in principle, this should give us an energy gain of 1 eV. But the ion that this actually becomes is so unstable that we only end up getting 0.4 eV after we have depopulated this radical state. But now at least it's very would like very much to react with the water. It can even get rid of this hydrogen over to the bridging groups, and then from here we can go through the same kind of reactions as before. So just to conclude, I tried to show you that we had some DFT approach within which we could try and model these photoreactions. And it sort of gives some, I'm maybe not convincing result, but it's something that we seem to be able to believe in. We saw that the holes were needed for the oxidation of methyl chloride, and that terminal oxygen and to some degree the terminal hydroxyl promotes the photo oxidation of methyl chloride. And then thank you for your attention.
Any questions or comments?
I have a question. Actually, stabilization metal chloride, can it be also due to the hydrogen bond between the O and OH species and
So the binding of that
due to the existence of holes in the non-surface form. What was one?
I didn't understand that completely.
Can the stabilization of this CH, so this you can see the reduced barrier, can be also due to the existence of hydrogen bonds? Not due to coal on the surface.
So at some point the hole is transferred to the molecule.
I think just from the bond between oxygen and hydrogen in this between this molecule and the terminal.
So that starts creating a very strong bond. So it really doesn't like to be terminal oxygen. They can be produced experimentally, but they are very reactive.
So this is due to this effect lowering down is due to the reaction of coal with the chloride and also due to hydrogen bonds within the oxygen and hydrogen.
Yeah, so I wouldn't call it a hydrogen bond, it's a covalent bond that gets created here. Yes.
By adding this OJ group, you hope that the electron completely transfers to the group, right?
Yes.
So did you ever measure if it's a fraction charge that goes to OH? OH or if it's fully charged with plus U, I guess you get the flu, but with PBE I'm not so sure.
Yeah, so with the DFT plus U I can completely move it to the terminal oxygen and then there's the hole. So the only thing I investigated was the projected dust and that's so the projector does until the OH group here lies, and that's until the P states of oxygen lies further down than the actual goal. So in principle, there could be a very small part, but I think the hole is smeared out of the whole crystal, and then it would be so if we had, I don't know, if we have 60 or so oxygen atoms, then it would be 1/60th part or something like that.
But it has a charge of one. I mean, this is
Yeah, I think so. Yes. Yeah. So the oxygen is 2-, but it's of course it's formally. So if we went in and did beta charge, then it would be closer to 1, and titanium closer to -1, and titanium closer to +2.
Okay, thank you. I think we move on.